Welcome to It's Your Date with Destiny with Apostle Vivian and Pastor Gemma Duncan of Divine Destiny Worship Center in Diego Martin. For the next 30 minutes, join us as we take you on a journey of maximizing your potential and realizing your goals through Jesus Christ.
Why is it when you need a miracle, it doesn't happen, but when you least expect it, it happens?
You are married. You have challenges in your relationship, but your spouse is unwilling to accede to any counseling. Is divorce an option?
How does a parent handle a promiscuous child?
What are considered the do's and don'ts of a born-again couple who is not yet married?
There are always more questions than answers. So here is Apostle Gemma.
Grace and peace to you. Welcome to Ask Pastor Gemma. As usual, I'm always grateful that you would have taken the time to be with me on Ask Pastor Gemma today. In the event that you are a first-timer, my name is Gemma Duncan. My husband and I, Apostle Vivian Duncan, are the pastors of Divine Destiny Worship Center. Our headquarters is located in Diego Martin on the Diego Martin Main Road in Trinidad. And we have branches in Sangre Grande in Chaguanas. It's a branch in Faisabad, one in Tobago, and we have a branch in Antigua. Our regularly scheduled services Sunday mornings at 9 a.m. And we are resuming our weekend services September 1st, which is Friday, September 1st, because we had been off for all of August. So join us September 1st. For first a weekday service online only. A gentle reminder that our business center opens from Monday to Friday from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. and the office hours are Monday to Thursday from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. I felt that I want to share two verses of scriptures, and they're both very well known to you. John 3:16, we all know it. It reads, "For God so loved the world, and he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And verse 17 of John chapter 3 says, "For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." And I felt I needed to start in that way because we live in a very unsafe world. There is no certainty. There is no hiding place. There is no safe place. And the only safe place is in God. You need divine protection. You need angelic protection. It doesn't matter what security system you may have, you're not safe, except God's protection is all around you. Except God, build a fence and a hedge around you. And the scripture says, "As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surround these people." And my prayer is, "Surround us, Lord." And I just thought that I would share with you that if you want that kind of protection, then Jesus Christ must become your Lord and Savior. You have to ask him very simply, give over the management of your life to Jesus. Let him be your Lord and your Savior and function and walk under divine protection. Today, we're going to begin some excerpts from Love Ministry, Marriage and the Singles of Divine Destiny Worship Center. The conference ran from July 13th to July 15th, 2023. And I thought that I would share some excerpts from that conference. Our facilitators were Dion and Leah Duncan of the Marriage Confessional. And when you view, they will tell you how to get on and subscribe to the Marriage Confessional. And the topic for the first session, session one, day one, was navigating change in marriage. And you will say, "Well, I'm single, and why is that a singles conference as well?" Simply because when you view those excerpts, you'll realize that it's preparing those people who are single for what is to come in marriage. So many times we're not prepared. Vivian and I we're not really prepared for marriage. Because of that, we had to learn the hard way. And hopefully, if you're single or going, or, you know, and call up somebody, married or single, and see what we can glean and give us, that will give us the tools and the keys to better negotiate our relationships.
We are going to be dealing with navigating change in marriage. Navigating change in marriage. Okay? Navigating change in marriage. And before we get into that topic for this evening, we want to know who here are subscribers of the Marriage Confessional on YouTube. Let me see your hands. Good. Hands down. Good job. If you are not subscribers, raise your hands. Excellent. So what we're going to do is we're going to take out our phones right now, and we're going to go to youtube.com. And if you could see, yes, you could see very well. Go to youtube.com and search The Marriage Confessional. The Marriage Confessional. We all have phones. This is 2023. Okay? This is 2023. We all have phones. Go to The Marriage Confessional. Subscribe. Subscribe to that little button you see there by the arrow. Yes, you hit subscribe. And we'll be doing this every evening until we ask the question, who here are subscribers? And everybody raises their hand. Okay? So this is our YouTube channel. As was read in our bio, we felt inspired to start this, and we've been doing so for some time. And for those lucky who are in attendance on Saturday, we will be recording a special episode right here during the conference. So, you know, home the hill a bit and do well nice. We might take a freeze frame picture and add it to the video. Okay? Good. So while you're doing that, navigating change in marriage. Navigating change in marriage. So change is constant. Nothing in life remains the same. Things always change. In Ecclesiastes chapter 3, which I will read a few verses from the NIV version. And it says, there's a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to uproot. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to scatter stones and a time to gather them up. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 5. When you read what the Bible talks about in Ecclesiastes and the imagery it gives about seasons, many of you who've been married for some time knows that, you know, marriage goes through seasons. And anybody could testify that marriage goes through seasons. As life changes, as we evolve, so too does the marriage that we have entered. The person who you married however long ago, the person who I was back in 2008 when we got married, definitely the core of me is still there. I'm still funny. I'm still good looking. But I've matured. I've changed. My tastes have changed. Things have changed. Experience has come and shaped the way how I think about things and view things. And the couples who struggle to adapt to that type of change usually have a rough go at it. The couples who, well, you said you'll always be X and you said you'll always be Y, but then life happened. And then to adapt themselves back to, you know, the space that they need to be to have that marriage be as efficient, as well going as possible, it's difficult. So the essence here that we want to talk about, and we'll talk about change some more throughout the weekend, is that there is good change, there is not so good change. There is change like evolution where people evolve into and you learn new skills, you learn new behaviors, you learn to improve certain things, you get qualified, all of those concepts. However, the issue here is how do you deal with it? And I'll give you a quick example. Finances. There could be a change in finances. It doesn't have to be a negative thing. Somebody could lose a job, and that person's salary was the way how the family maintained their lifestyle. And of course, it's going to be a struggle. And how do you deal with that? But there's also, on the flip side, somebody could land their dream job, but now that dream job requires that person to be away all the time. What do you do? So it's not only negative change that causes consternation in marriages. It's any type of change. So the idea here that we're trying to put across is, how do you navigate that change to make the marriage worthwhile? Okay? But we'll talk about that more tomorrow. Now, in the context of change, this is how we landed at, for those of you who watched episode 23 in the Marriage Confessional, the Pyramid of Love. Anybody saw episode 23? Good, good. I see one hand. That means we're going to get like 150 views tonight and tomorrow. Okay, because that's going to be something that you have to work on. Watch that episode. The Pyramid of Love. And what it was we were, both my wife, Apostle Leah, and I were having a conversation to each other and to the audience who were viewing about some lessons that we learned in the 14 years that we've been married. So both Apostle Leah and I have been married 14 years. We're going to be married 15 years in December.
Yes.
15 whole years. Like 1-5. Come on, I could clap better than that. And what the pyramid was at that, when we brought it up in that episode, was a reflection of the last 14 years that we lived. And what I realized as one of the lessons learned was that my understanding of myself, first of all, but my understanding of what love meant was one thing back then. Now, almost 15 years later, it's something totally much more compounded and complex than what it was before. And we'll talk about what the pyramid is as we have this conversation. So, if you look at the monitors, we are going to build the pyramid and have a conversation while we build it, okay? So I'm going to start. The left side is Dion. So the first thing I felt when I met Leah was attraction. Come on, she's a good-looking young lady. Come on, give God praise for good looks and good genes. Hallelujah. Selective genes. Hallelujah. But for me, it was attraction. We met 1997, maybe, as we were teenagers. And our parents used to hang out in the same circles, you know, in the 80s into the 90s. But we were little kids. Apparently, we played together. I can't remember that stuff. All I know is that when I met her, I was 14, and I was like, whoa! Whoa! Let's do this. And I felt attraction. That was, for me, the entrance criteria that just said, oh my goodness, I like you. I like you a lot. Okay? So for me, it was attraction. However,
on my side, so wait, I'm going to tell the story of how we met.
You want to tell the story how we met? All right.
The official story.
Are you ready for that story? Let's go to the story.
So, we met, well, as you said, you know, we sort of, our families knew each other, etc. But we became aware of each other one day. Our older siblings were friends and they would hang out occasionally. So I decided to tag along one day. They were going to KFC in Arima. So I decided to go.
Anybody remember when KFC was a flex?
In Arima.
Like for real, real, when KFC was a flex. Everybody was like, what's a flex? A flex is when it used to be the vibe. When you were a teenager, you had nothing else to do. You leave home and you go to KFC, you buy fries, and you sit there for 5 hours. Exactly. Go ahead.
So, anyways. They were going to KFC. I decided to tag along. And we went upstairs, sitting down, talking, whatever, eating. And then suddenly, this guy...
The life of the party showed up.
This guy comes upstairs and comes around. Apparently, he got home and realized his brother was not there and wanted to go where he was. So that's kind of how he came. And when he came upstairs, he sat down and we just talked and laughed and that was it. And I was...
No. We didn't just talk and laugh. Tell them how funny I was.
I mean, he was funny. He was a funny guy.
Tell them how funny I was. I was very funny.
Okay. All right, honey. He was funny. And, I mean, to me, I mean, I was like, what, four? You were 15, I was 14.
I was 14.
I was turning 14 or something like that, around that age. And to me, it's like, okay, he's a cool guy. I mean, I'm not really into boys or anything at that age. I'm like, okay, he's cool. And that was it. There was no attraction right away. I wasn't thinking about, ooh, I really like this boy. I want him to be my boyfriend or anything like that. There was nothing like that in my brain. It was only sort of later on that came about. But it was just like, oh, he's funny.
Made me work, guys.
and that was my initial interaction with him. You know, it was positive, but there was not like an instant, oh my gosh, like I like this guy. I mean, I know this these days is like kids are a bit more advanced and different, but back then it was just not something I was really interested in at any time. Right, and then okay, over time, right, because we sort of hung out in the same circles, and also because Dr. Jade was my best friend from since back then. We began to just hang out more. We went to gospel concerts. We, you know, did things. And I was like, well, you know, he's not so bad. You know, he's a nice guy. You know, he seems like he has good values. Obviously, he comes from a good family. You know, our parents know each other. And then over time, we started to, you know, develop. Then came that sort of attraction, that friendship, and then it sort of evolved from there for me. We became friends, and then after we became friends, I began to really find out who he was and what he was about. Then became, you know, there was sort of attraction started building there for me when I sort of began to dig and learn about him and who he was, his values and his character and all of that.
And I think the reason why we wanted to highlight that is because, you know, everybody has their own criteria. Everybody comes from different backgrounds, different experiences, because, you know, the assumption that a lot of people like to make is when you enter in a marriage, maybe it's not the person's first time being in a serious relationship. So everybody have different reasons and different criteria, let's just leave it like that. And even though we both ended up eventually at attraction, for me it was instant, it was like done deal. But for her, it took time. I needed to be funny like 15 times, and you know, I need to work my way. But seriously, it took time for us to get to know each other, and eventually that attraction started. And I think that's important, especially for the singles out there, because you know, we like to have a lot of, in the Instagram generation, where if you don't wow me the first time, then slide. Next frame, next person. And I think we are so fast in using just physical attraction as an entrance point that you miss an opportunity sometimes to get to know somebody for who they are. And really and truly, when you get to know someone and you realize that there's a meshing, sometimes, you know, those glasses come on and it's like, oh, you're not so bad after all. I think that's important. That's really, really important. And that's an idea that we want you to take away so far.
When I found you, I found somebody who cares. When I found you, found my most intimate prayer. When I found you, count what every heart dreams of. When I found you, I found love. When I found you, I found the rest of my life. When I found you, I told all others goodbye. When I found you, I saw my fears fly away like a dove. When I found you, I found love.
Grace and peace to you. Today, I want to introduce to you a very special program that has been hosted by Divine Destiny Worship Center since 2014. My name is Gemma Duncan. My husband and I, Apostle Vivian Duncan, are the pastors of Divine Destiny Worship Center, and our headquarters is located on the Digo Martin Main Road in Trinidad. This special program is called the School of the Bible. School of the Bible is a one-year program that caters primarily for persons who would have thought these thoughts. Is there a way that I can understand the Bible better? I do not necessarily want to be a pastor, but I would love to have a better grasp of the Bible. I read the Bible, but I walk away not understanding anything and remembering very little. I sit down in the pews, the pastor preaches. When I walk away, I could barely recall what he said. These are the people that we are catering for, because primarily, School of the Bible is expected to help you to understand the Bible better. Despite the specific group, we've had pastors who came and thought that the program would help them to just review and revise and so on, and help them better to minister to their people. Now, as I said, it's 1 year. We meet every Tuesday from 7 to 9 p.m. And over the past 3 years, 4 years, we've been meeting online due to COVID. And we have not shifted. So now it's an online program, except people indicate that they are interested and that we have enough participants to meet in person. And all we do is go through the entire Bible from Genesis to Revelation. We actually use only the Bible and the 7 manuals. And the manuals are the books of the law, the books of history, the books of poetry, the books of prophecy, the Gospels and Acts, the Pauline epistles, and the general epistles and Revelation. If you are in Europe or any other country with a different time zone from us in Trinidad, we will cater for you. We've had students from those places and we make special arrangements for you. What's the rationale for School of the Bible? In Ephesians 6 verse 17, it reads, "And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God." That scripture tells us that God's word is our only weapon of offense. Since 2014, we've had over 800 persons and hailing from Trinidad and Tobago, the Caribbean Islands, Europe, Canada, USA. We offer 3 tracks, all-in track, where you do the full program, the auditing track, which is less work, the auxiliary track, which removes assignment and assessment. But when you indicate us your interest, we are going to send you a brochure, and the brochure will give you all the information. You can call us at 633-3780 from Monday to Thursdays between the hours of 10 a.m. and 3 p.m. That's the office. Or you can reach us at any time at SOTB, SOTB stands for School of the Bible, at ddwc.net. SOTB at ddwc.net. If you call, we will explain a little more, ask your questions, and we'll answer. If you WhatsApp us there, a brochure will be sent to you as long as you request it with all of the information. See you in School of the Bible in 2024. I pray that God will guide you along to improve your communication in and out of marriage and as intended to help you to have a better marriage. And Jesus' own word says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. no man comes to the Father except by me.